Hi folks, CodeTutor here, and my name is Anil Deshpande. Welcome to the second video of Refactoring for Solid Compliance series. In the previous video, we had a detailed look at simple college management system requirement specifications. We also understood how it was failing on SRP principle, that is single responsibility principle. Time to refactor for SRP. But where to get started? What we can do is we can create staff manager. Staff manager will be responsible for staff related operations such as assigning staff to the department and calculating the salaries. And then you can also create student manager. Student manager will handle the things like student registration and engagement with staff. It will isolate the student related operations from the college, which right now is also trying to do the registration of the students. And in the same way, the staff manager will handle the assigning of the staff to the department. The college can be made a little bit more simple. And then you can create classes like engagement manager and salary manager, which can be introduced to handle very specific tasks, further breaking down the responsibilities. So let's start doing that and see what do we get. Let's start going through the classes and see how many of those are SRP and how many of them are not compliant with SRP. Address, yeah, it seems to be all right. College, anyhow, as we discussed, we will have to break. Course, once again, seems that it is not doing anything other than what it is supposed to do. So it is already compliant with the SRP. Department, once again, doesn't have any other functionality other than holding the data. So seems all right. Then staff, as we discussed, we will have to break it. And then student seems to be already pretty much well placed. So what we will do is, let me create a class called as staff manager. What this will do is it will do the work of assigning the staff to the department, and then it will also do the salary calculation. And once again, for doing the salary calculation, instead of doing it here in the staff manager, it is better to do it through another kind of a manager. So we can use a salary manager to do that. So let's create salary manager. Let me create a Kotlin class, salary manager, that should have a function called calculate salary, and it should take the parameter of staff. If you look at this particular code, you might be wondering why we are doing the calculation of the salary directly here. Wouldn't it be prudent to delegate this to another class, probably call it as a salary calculator instead of directly doing it here? But we are doing it here because we want to just keep the number of classes that we want to manage in this example to the very bare minimum. But yeah, that's very much possible. So now going back to the staff manager class, I can now write a function here which will do the salary calculation using the salary manager, but we need to pass the salary manager as the argument to the staff manager. So that will take care of calculation of the salary manager. And other than that, we can now have a function which will do work of assigning the staff to the department. And in the same way, we can create student manager. Let me create a class called student manager. And this will basically have two functions, that is register student, which is right now happening in another class. If I'm not wrong, register is right now happening directly in the college. That should not be happening here. We can manage it here in the student manager. And in the same way, engage student is happening in the staff. So we can move those things to the student manager. So let me write the function to do the student registration, which is pretty straightforward. But then there are various kinds of engagements that are happening. I think it would be better to create a kind of an engagement manager, which student manager can use to engage with the students. So let me create another class called as engagement manager. And this will have a function called as engagement students. It basically takes three parameters, that is staff, subject, and list of students. And it right now is printing pretty simple stuff, but depending upon what you really want, you can make it as much complicated as possible. And now we can use this particular engagement manager in the student manager to engage with the students. So I can now have engagement manager being passed as the constructor argument to the student manager so that engaged students will use this engagement manager to engage with the students. Now, with that done, what I can do is I can go to the student here. I can get rid of this function because now we are doing it through the staff manager. And in the same way, are there any other classes? We have staff manager, student, student manager, salary manager, engagement manager, department, course. College will now have a couple of more things. We can have, well, staff manager, and then also have, well, student manager. With this, register student can be delegated to the student manager. Dot register student. I can pass both the student and list of students, or depending upon how it has been written, students/student, and then assign staff to department. That can be now done by the staff manager dot assign staff to department. I can pass the staff and the department. Can get rid of these println statements, and then we can have a function calculate staff salary that can be managed through the staff manager dot calculate staff salary, and that in turn will be using the salary manager. So that is one more delegation. And then finally, we can use student manager to do the engagement of the students. That is basically assign staff, subject, and students to bind them together and create an engagement. So now with this, you can actually see that each class has a clear focused responsibility. So if you just observe here, the number of classes have increased. I mean, to get a very quick comparison, let me show you. This is how our previous UML diagram for the class hierarchy for unfactored code with violating solid principles looked like. But with the modification that we have added, this is how it looks like now. So now you have a college that has dedicated staff manager and student manager. Staff manager uses the salary manager. Student manager and engagement manager are basically being used to create a binding between the staff, subject, and students. And college is not doing everything on its own. It is basically delegating its work to staff manager and student manager. And staff manager is in turn using salary manager and engagement manager. And all our other classes like address, student, course, department, staff have now pretty much become just like data classes, or what you sometimes can also call as bean classes. They don't have any functionality as such. They just are the containers to hold the data. You now have created a separate set of managers to manage these different objects. So if I try to put it in a nutshell, when you do the code refactoring to achieve single responsibility principle, what you will end up doing is basically breaking up the classes based on what you are seeing in the classes. It could be attributes or it could be functionalities in the classes. You will break them into multiple classes, move the functionalities into separate set of classes. They might be managers in this case, and then make the original classes as much as simple, making them almost like data classes or bean classes. And that is what you can foresee when you are refactoring your code to make it compliant with single responsibility principle. However, this code still violates a lot of other principles. And if the assumptions change in our requirements, then probably we will have to go back to the table and redraw this structure again. But as of now, with whatever the classes that we have with our current design, this is the very bare minimum single responsibility principle compliant code that would look like. And because you refactor your code like this, the number of classes have increased from the previous to the current. Here you can see that there are 10 classes after making it compliant with single responsibility principle. But before we did that, we only had 6 classes. So from 6, we ended up with 10 classes. Just park this particular thought, and as we go through the next set of discussions to make it compliant with, say, open and close principle, list call substitution principle, and so on, you will start seeing a pattern emerge here, and we will use that to better frame our understanding of what basically happens when we start refactoring code as per solid principle adherence. So thanks for your time. Stay tuned for next video.
That brings us to the end of this particular video. Don't forget to like, comment, share the video, and subscribe to the channel. Take care. Bye.